Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome on stage David Rowan, editor at Wired Magazine UK.
Hello, good morning. Very nice to be in Bucharest. I meet some crazy people, and I'm going to tell you how the world is changing through what I'm learning from them. This man is on the front cover of Wired magazine this month. He's a Swiss adventurer who I met 7 years ago, and he told me he wanted to fly an aeroplane around the world using zero fuel, which sounded like a science fiction idea. But he explained that solar panels were becoming more powerful, cheaper, on the exponential curve, and he wanted to use just solar power to get around the world. And we kind of followed him at Wired. His name's Bertrand Picard, he's from Switzerland. And lo and behold, this July, he landed in Abu Dhabi, completing his round the world journey. And I'm constantly meeting entrepreneurs who are ignoring this idea that some things just can't happen, that they're impossible. And they're using the tools of technology that are accelerating in their availability, in their falling price, in their utility, to build a future. And I'm going to talk a little bit about this accelerating pace of change, which is why I think the world will never move as slowly as it is now. But just talking about what's happening in the sky. Who here thinks we will be traveling around Bucharest in flying cars in 5 years? Any hands? I see six brave hands. This future is here now. This is one of about 15 startups I'm aware of that are making flying cars. This one is in Slovakia, it's called Aeromobile. Sometimes it crashes, but most of the time it gets up in the air. But this is that science fiction idea as just another startup. You don't need huge funding, you can go to the crowdfunding. You don't need your own huge factory, you can use excess capacity. Larry Page is investing $100 million in two flying car startups. Airbus in August said it was working on flying cars. So I'm having to constantly reassess everything I think I understand. I thought I knew what drones were. Okay, so 10 years ago you had to be the military. Now, for €400 or €500, you can have a pretty good drone in the park taking photographs. In January, I had to admit I was completely wrong. A Chinese company called Ehang demonstrates at the Consumer Electronics Show in Las Vegas that a drone is now something to carry a person. It has no steering wheel, just a touch screen. And they've had licensing. They're now testing in the United States.
We have the application designed for Ehang 184. After setting up the flight plan with a single click, user can take off on any location, sit, relax, and enjoy the flight.
Are you ready for your flight?
Ehang will always
I'm actually going to take the bus, but
beginning.
This technology hits the culture in unexpected ways. This is not some crazy future. This is happening now. It's being tested. But also it hits like the gaming culture. So out of nowhere, we've got this new sport called drone racing, where you wear the virtual reality goggles. You get the point of view of the drone. This is turning into a very big business suddenly. Sky has just paid $1 million for one of the rights to the drone racing league. So if drone racing isn't your thing, there's drone boarding. A couple of kids in Russia start putting these videos online, and it becomes a movement. Changes the whole idea of the selfie. You have to have a droney. So there are hundreds of channels online, people like Alex Chacon here, travel around the world with drones, making himself look handsome in exotic locations. And he's got millions of views. And I guess if you're Alex Chacon's girlfriend, you're gonna get no attention because he's paying all his attention up there. So,
oh my gosh, this
future is coming.
I'm not touching it at all, and It's driving. Whoa, the lanes are getting a little. Oh, no, there it goes. And it's
so the first time you go into a self-driving car, it's going to be weird, but soon it becomes the norm. So this is a Tesla that downloaded the software by itself overnight to become autonomous. So I'm quite interested in where technology meets human behavior, because that creates opportunity.
This is a conventional 18-wheeler that drives itself, thanks to a $30,000 retrofit. San Francisco startup Auto, which Uber bought this summer, made history with this truck. It completed the world's first truck autonomous delivery, carrying 50,000 cans of Budweiser from a brewery.
The world's first self-driving truck goes on the road a couple of weeks ago, and its mission to deliver 50,000 cans of beer. I think that is what I call progress. This is not going to be news soon. This is just going to be another way that the supply chain works, another way that we're all connected. And regulators are going to have to catch up. And the existing car truck manufacturers are going to realize their business model is radically challenged. You can't really ignore this future. And think of what automation is doing and how quickly we're going from the extreme research labs to the mainstream. Boston Dynamics used to make robots for the military. Then they start working on robots for the warehouse and robots for your house. Although they spend most of their time at Boston Dynamics teasing their robots, which I don't think is a very wise thing to do myself. But again, the cost and power of the sensors is hitting one of those exponential curves. So if it falls over, it can pick itself up. And this is just a metaphor for what's happening to the wider economy. So, the conclusion that I'm seeing when I'm traveling, meeting the researchers and the startups and the investors, is you can't rest. If you don't change your business processes now, you risk getting left behind. This exponential curve is a real thing. They're obsessed with it. You go to the West Coast, you go to places like Singularity University, this is like the religion. And there's a reason for this. So something that was expensive suddenly becomes free. Let's just say it's 1994 when computer storage is still $1,000 per gig. And I'd approached you and said, let's start a business, let's give away petabytes of computer storage. We'll become billionaires. We'll call it Dropbox. Makes no sense, but because of that curve, there's an inflection point. Maybe 8 years later, that is a fantastic business opportunity. And the same curve is hitting solar power. It's hitting the sequencing cost of DNA. This is a logarithmic scale, so 15 years ago, to sequence one human was $100 million. Now, it's a few hundred dollars. Soon it will be the price of a cup of coffee. What does this mean for healthcare? What does this mean for the state tracking citizens just with a bit of saliva here and there? The rules that we grew up with no longer mean anything. A new device is going to come along, a new technology, and whether you survive or not, I think, is going to be determined by your attitude, how you react. So in 1983, this gadget hit the market, with some celebrities endorsing it. But let's say you're the big incumbent. Let's say you are AT&T, the American company that had more landlines than anybody else in the world. Millions of miles of copper cable connecting Americans to their landlines. Do you ignore it as a fad, or do you invest big time thinking this is the future? So AT&T didn't know, even though they owned Bell Labs, which designed a lot of the IP for the mobile telephone. They had to call in the consultants. And they called in McKinsey to say, we don't know if this mobile telephone gadget is going to be something worth looking at. Could you tell us how many you think there'll be in America by the end of the 20th century, in 17 years? And McKinsey goes and does its number crunching, and it comes back with a figure. And McKinsey said, we think this mobile telephone device could be quite significant. We think there could be almost 1 million mobile telephones in America, which wasn't a bad guess. It was slightly out. And there's three lessons that we can all learn from, I think, McKinsey's mistake. First of all, it's Moore's law, the form factor, it changes, it becomes more convenient, it becomes smaller. Never forget that today's form factor is not going to be necessarily what catches on. The second mistake they made was they calculated in terms of the technology. And what determines if something will win is not the megahertz, the megabits. It's, does this enhance my identity? Does this connect me to people, to hobbies that I love? And I think the smartphone is about an extension of you. And the third mistake McKinsey made was they framed their thinking in a very fixed 1983 way. And social norms change, sometimes very quickly. In 1983, if you wanted to make a phone call, you would go to the phone box, you would go back to the office. Just think today, if you take this away from a 15-year-old for more than 6 seconds, it's a human rights abuse, and you will be sent to The Hague. So I'm quite interested in how we're dishonest about our own behavior. We're very irrational, but we try not to admit it. Somebody posted a question on the chat forum Reddit 2 years ago, that if somebody from the 1950s suddenly came back now, what would be the hardest thing to explain to them about modern life? And my favorite answer was, I have a device in my pocket that's capable of accessing the entirety of information known to man, and I use it to look at pictures of cats and to get into arguments with strangers. And I think if you were honest about your own behavior, these technologies are making you slightly irrational. We're now so addicted to our apps that there are apps just to tell you how many times a day you're checking your app. So there are new medical conditions. This one is called the three-dot anxiety. And we've also had to redraw Maslow's hierarchy of human needs because of this new world. But you can't argue with behavior. And it changes how money goes through the economy. A couple of years ago, Kim issues a game for Android, for iOS, free. You don't have to pay to download it. You can pay a tiny bit of money inside the game to move more quickly. Within 5 months, her free game had earned her $43 million. Now, I'm not an economist, but that doesn't seem very rational to me. But that's how things are moving. So I'm going to give you, based on my travels through the startup world and meeting corporates that are trying to understand this, I guess kind of 8 pieces of advice that I would give to the successful ones to keep up. And the first one, the companies that seem to have a more guaranteed future are embracing artificial intelligence in all its forms, in machine learning, because that is the new reality. And it's come very quickly from the science lab to frontline of business. So we're already starting to take for granted that we talk to our devices and they respond, so no need for the mouse or the keyboard. But I think this is just the beginning, and I'm going to explain why in computer vision, in some of the other kind of adaptive learning processes, the machine is starting to be our friend, but starting to be completely impossible to ignore. Here's an example of a free piece of open source software. It's called NeuralTalk. This guy's downloaded it, and he's put it on his laptop, and he's walking through Amsterdam, and it's using the webcam to describe in words what it thinks it's seeing. So it's a computer vision piece of AI. And if you see how accurate those words are and how quickly they're describing things, it's quicker than I can actually read them out. And this is not part of a big company that's developed its own IP. This is something anybody can pick up and play with and adapt. And this is 2016. So I'm thinking, in 5 years, what is the chance that anything will not be described in real time by the cameras that there are ubiquitously everywhere? What about lip reading? Can you read that? So here's a piece of software that has 93% accuracy.
Place blue in M1 soon.
Try this one. are, but the machine knows.
Lay red in X-ray soon.
Who wants to volunteer? I'll give you one more chance.
Set green with U0 again.
So, this was only released last week, but it's one of 1,000 examples I'm seeing of machine learning kind of taking over. Listen to the soundtrack on this video. Seems a pretty ordinary pop song as background, doesn't it? Except this pop song was written by an AI. There's a London startup called Duke Deck that's using algorithms to compose music, and it's getting better and better and better. So the machine is now able to manifest creativity, which is something we thought was going to be really difficult. But where it's going to get really interesting for business is the AI as the chat interface through what's being called the bot. The conversational interface, most of our time is being spent online through the messaging interface. And what if the conversations we have with our friends are replicated by the conversations we have with the businesses we deal with in a very simple human-like chattable way, where there isn't a human being at the other side, where the machine understands what we're telling it and answers and saves us time? Because nobody wants to wait for the gas company to reply to their email. Nobody wants to stand waiting on the phone call for the airline to answer. We want everything right now. And in the next couple of years, we're going to see a huge growth in chatbots. This is one example. This is the messaging app Kick, and this is H&M using it to talk to customers. It can suggest clothes, it can answer your questions about what colors, what stock, what sizes they have. Then it can send you a map when something is about to come to be delivered. Then you can deal with customer service afterwards. I was talking to Phil Leiben, who invented Evernote. He's now an investor at General Assembly, and he's only investing in bots because he says these are going to be bigger than apps, because they solve a lot of the problems that apps don't solve. You don't have to fire up a separate app each time you want to do something different. They start to understand you. They learn. So ignore the bot at your peril. And the machine is also getting good at understanding not just what you're telling it, but your emotion. This is a piece of software called Sitecore that's scanning a crowd in real time. And what these boxes are doing, it's quite small, but they're telling you not just the demographic, this is a white woman, age 37 to 40, but also breaking down in percentage her emotion, how much fear, anger, happiness, sadness, disgust she is manifesting, which could be pretty useful if you're trying to monitor the reaction to a political rally, how people like testing your product. Because we're in a world now where emotion is just another data point. Here's a company that was actually recently bought by Apple that's also trying to understand what you're feeling.
What if your devices could read your emotions and respond to them? Emotions is developing technology to do just that. Our industry-leading emotion-aware system will enable a revolution in device and application personalization. We're taking more pictures and videos than ever before. Imagine organizing this content by emotion so your most memorable moments are easier to find.
So now Tim Cook knows exactly what you're feeling today. Although my favorite example of face recognition so far is this American company, ChurchX, which sells its services to churches so they can know who pretended to be in the congregation on Sunday but wasn't actually there. Oh, free enterprise. Second thing I'm seeing in the companies that get it, you know, this is an obvious thing, but it's kind of intriguing how we're still learning new ways to use data to get an unfair advantage. Just a couple of random examples. Caleb Harper in MIT Media Lab comes from a farming background, grew up on a ranch, and is obsessed with optimizing the efficiency of the way we grow crops, and in fact allowing us to grow crops anywhere to save them being trucked long distance. He's developed a project that allows you to grow inside very controlled environments where you control different LEDs, you control temperature, you control water, you control nutrition. His project is called City Farm, and he's building these little, what he calls, food computers, because once you turn weather, nutrition, light into data, then you can grow your lettuce, your broccoli, in a quarter of the time with only maybe a third of the nutrients. Well, this man who has an unfair advantage because he tracks what is selling and he doesn't share that information. So on Amazon, the marketplace, suddenly if something looks like it's that week's big success, the data gets turned into information, and then Amazon makes its own generic version of such products, and look, rather than $60, $19.99, because nobody else has this data. I heard Mark Benioff a couple of months ago talking about his obsession with keeping his teeth clean. He always carries one of these toothbrushes. He said, though, I've bought probably 100 of these Philips toothbrushes, but I keep leaving them in hotel bathrooms. I always leave them when I'm traveling. And all my relationship so far has been with the retailer, with Costco. So Philips doesn't know who I am. Except the new version of this toothbrush, the Philips Sonicare, is an Internet of Things version. You can connect to the network, record how regularly you're brushing, how efficiently you're doing it. And he said, for the first time, Philips has a relationship with me. And if you think about it, this is just a toothbrush. But as we network every physical device, as we are giving away infinite amounts of data through our behavior, through our phones, through our movements, suddenly all sorts of companies that didn't really know anything about us have access to providing personal bespoke services to helping us get what we want. And we're at the beginning. I was in China in August trying to understand how you know what people are buying in the stores across China, in particular the villages across China. And there's a very ambitious project which I'm writing about. The richest man in Hong Kong, Li Ka-shing, has got together with the Chinese post office to put point of sale devices in village stores across China. He's hoping to do 1 million of them. So far they've done a couple of 100,000. And what this means is, for the first time, the villages, typically 1,000 people living in a village, in the old days, like last year, people would pay cash. They could only buy what was in the store. Now that there's a point of sale device in the store, you can buy what's in the store, but also the shopkeepers can connect online with a bigger inventory. The retailers or the manufacturers can know what people are buying by querying the database in real time. If you are Chanel and you want to know what Dior products that women aged 46 to 49 are buying in villages 2 to 2.5 hours commute from the nearest city, you can know in the next minute what they've been buying in the last hour. So suddenly, China has a massive data advantage over any European or American retail marketing organization, because they've connected it to the network. Final example, this is a couple of guys in Tel Aviv, Matan and Ami. They're connecting, through their company Windward, 200,000 ships on the sea. They're using satellite data to track individual ships. They've got algorithms analyzing them. A lot of ships are not what they claim to be. They're using fake call signs. They switch off their signals when they're doing things they shouldn't. These guys at Windward are selling their data to intelligence agencies. They are selling it to nonprofits. They can tell when There's overfishing that's illegal. They can tell when a ship is going to meet another ship coming from Libya, maybe with weapons, taking it to Italy. It's a data play, but nobody else has this data. Because we're all on the network, the companies that I'm really excited about at the moment are using the network as a platform in new ways. Three guys in Paris had an idea for a hitchhiking app. They will connect you to other people who are driving between cities, long distance. They couldn't get funding. Investors said, why would I want to spend 3 hours in a car with a stranger? It turns out that millions of Europeans and people in Turkey and people elsewhere want this. Their app, Blah Blah Car, is now valued in the billions of euros because the network solves problems. The driver gets a bit of gas money, maybe a bit of company. You get a cheaper ride than taking the train, and it's got a social aspect. In China, I met this guy who runs a company called Logi, which connects truck drivers with the people with cargo. In the old days, last year, the truck driver would turn up at a certain bit of the town at 3 a.m, and there'd be a chalkboard with people saying, this is what we need carried, and they'd bid for it. In the new world, through Logi, it's all happening online, and for the first time, they can plan to get a return journey. He gives away the service. He doesn't charge for the connecting, but because he knows the movements of every trucker through their smartphone, he knows that they're not going over the speed limit, he knows how regularly they're in work, he's able to let them borrow money at half the price they could from the bank, because they suddenly have a credit record. He's allowing them to insure their trucks at a cheaper price, because it proves that they're safe drivers. Data as power. Connecting the network, this is just another example. A company started in Belgium, is now in France and the UK. If you don't want to buy food from a restaurant, well, people who cook at home, who are good cooks, they list their food, and neighbors can come round and buy them. It's maybe 8 or 9 euros. Menu next door is growing very quickly. So we're at a kind of revolutionary moment in a literal sense. We're moving from the power of the hierarchy to the network. And that means, you know, took these guys 93 years to get 650,000 rooms, took these guys 2 years to get more than 1 million rooms, and they don't have to change the sheets. And because when you connect people on the network, we're still at that early stage, you solve problems. Insurance is getting networked with peer-to-peer companies. This phone company in China, OnePlus, is using its network, its chat boards, both to market its phones, but also to suggest improvements. Every week they release new software based on what the chat boards are saying. They release new hardware. The chat forum said, we really like a bamboo shell for our phone. It becomes a really popular item. So old world, if you wanted to make hardware, you'd need a factory in Shenzhen. New world, you go to the network, like Eric did when he had an idea for a smartwatch 2 years before Apple was talking about one. And Kickstarter gives you $20 million, and you have a brand, and you have customers, and you have marketing. And this is just the beginning. So the platform means you don't need a central bank. And it's not about the Bitcoin, actually. It's more about the blockchain that underlines what's happening. You can use the blockchain, this distributed register of transactions, to solve problems. I saw a startup a couple of weeks ago that's using the blockchain to ensure that the refugees are getting the aid that they're meant to have and it doesn't go missing on the way. The old system, a lot of corruption. Paper vouchers, they could get faked. New system, you check at the point of distribution. The British government has been looking at putting the land registry on the blockchain. It's been looking at controlling welfare payments through the blockchain, because it's really hard to fake a distributed ledger. The entrepreneurs I get excited about are seeing a problem and reframing it. And I think in a world where a lot of industries are being commodified, because technology is ubiquitous and cheap, this is a really useful skill. One example, Josh Kushner made a lot of money investing in startups, then decides to take on an industry he knows nothing about, insurance, health insurance. In America, people hate their health insurer. He's in New York. So he decides to create an insurance company based on framing it as a tech company. He talks about Oscar as a design and data company. They do behavioral science. He talks about user experience. From nowhere, Oscar becomes one of the big players in health insurance. Or a commodified product. Hundreds of companies making HD cameras. Why is GoPro the big profitable one? Because it doesn't frame itself as a camera company. It frames itself as the place you share your experience of living the adventurous lifestyle. You share your videos on its website when you ski into an avalanche. Don't try this at home, please. There's a lot of friction in our lives, and increasingly we're intolerant. So the entrepreneurs who have an unfair advantage are those that start out by trying to remove that friction. Biggest example I've seen is Jan Koum, comes from Ukraine, age 16, as a refugee to America, lives on welfare, gets very frustrated at the cost of calling his family back in Kiev, so invents an app. By the time I went to see him 3 years ago, he had almost 500 million active monthly users of WhatsApp. And there was a post-it note that had been there for a couple of years from his co-founder on his desktop, reminding him to keep it simple. Just make it work. They were obsessed with uptime. They didn't want to add extra emojis, extra services. They didn't want to do voice until they knew everything worked. So this company that was then bought by Facebook for 19 billion, how much did they spend getting their 500 million customers, as it was then, on marketing plus advertising plus PR? A grand total of nothing, because if you design something that is friction-free, your community will do the marketing. It just works. Although when the BBC reported the sale for 19 billion, it said it was because Mark Zuckerberg saw it as an incredibly valuable WhatsApp massaging service, which to me explained the valuation in a much more clear way. Designers talk a lot about this thing called the desire path, which is the path that humans will take no matter what journey you hope they should take. And think of every interaction you have. You want that desire path. You do not want to have to log in to that hotel Wi-Fi. You do not want to have ads that are in your way. Now, the advertising companies, the publishers are suing IO, the company behind Adblock Plus. 500 million downloads. They should be thanking them for giving them feedback that people think their product sucks, because otherwise they wouldn't try and avoid the advertising. This is valuable feedback. There is a generation now that's never going to do this because you just don't need to. You know, why do you need to go through this horrible system when the data in the device says who you are? Think about the companies you like the most, and it's the, you know, the touch a button, magic happens. What about getting out of the car after you've had your cab? You don't have to do anything to pay. You don't even need to have to touch the screen. When you get a new account in a service like Uber, you don't even need to type in your credit card number. It's designed around that friction. You photograph it, it does the rest. So we're even now getting, because people are so lazy, they want everything now. This is a company that's been testing in London, delivering with a robot. This is called Starship Technologies. Some Skype founders built it because they think we won't wait. Although good luck testing this on some of the streets in South London. I don't think you're going to get your robot back. The companies that get it keep innovating by testing their ideas, mixing with people who think in a very different way. Tony Hsieh built up a big shoe retailer called Zappos, which sold for $1 billion. He wants his office to be like a party. This is his office in downtown Las Vegas. And he thinks that the only way we're going to keep ourselves relevant is that party sense where you can be surprised by somebody new coming in. And he's based in the very poor part of Las Vegas, the downtown part, 20, 30 kilometers away from most of the casinos. Except he's investing $350 million of his own money, trying to turn it into a creative hub, funding startups, funding cool restaurants, funding nurseries and public theaters. And he says he wants to create a space that's like a town square where the three C's happen. People collide, ideas collide, people learn together, and there's connectedness. And I guess a lot of these people on the West Coast are influenced by the kind of Burning Man mentality. 70, 80,000 people go to the desert in Nevada for a week in August, build a city. There's no cash economy, it's just a gift economy, a creative economy. But because they make up the rules as they go along. It's a kind of creative, magical place. You wouldn't have companies like Airbnb were it not for the social experimentation of places like Burning Man. And that's starting to affect how people are thinking about the workplace. When Steve Jobs took over Pixar, there'd been plans to knock down the building, create three buildings, one for the animators, one for the producers, one for the management. He said, no, we need one building and one central set of toilets near the entrance that everybody has to go into. So the accountant will have a conversation with the animator, so everybody will understand a different way of thinking about things. There's new workspaces. This is one in London called Second Home. It's a shared workspace. You can have your closed, glass-walled booth, but you also have the common areas where you meet other people. So it's everything from ad agencies to hardware startups to virtual reality companies to the finance tech incubator of a bank, because it's where ideas collide. That gives you an advantage. This is a new building in London. It's called the Crick Institute that opened a couple of weeks ago, next to St. Pancras Station, huge building. It's trying to solve cancer. It's a biomedical research center funded by the Wellcome Trust Cancer Research. It's the biggest biomedical research center in Europe. And there's no walls on the inside. So they've designed it so that the biochemist will meet the information designer, will run into the physicist, because they know that if you're going to solve a big problem, you need to think in a way that you haven't thought of before. So we need in our own organizations to get rid of those walls and to talk to people outside those organizations. We're not going to connect with the network in the same way that we did. So this is one thing that's going to be very big in the Christmas present wish list this year. There's a lot of these sorts of products. Going to be significant, I guess, initially for games, but a lot more. So the HoloLens is being targeted particularly to help you do your business conferencing. You can collaborate with other people over long distances. But it's going to be really interesting. So we don't know, because it's very early. This is one example from a filmmaker called Keiichi Matsuda. When there is a virtual world imposed, an augmented world on our shopping trip, could be really spammy, it could be really busy. We just know that the way we interact is going to be challenged. Because all this technology is here now. It's up to us to work out how we want to use it. And then, you can simulate an entire world. This is a London company called Improbable that allows you to simulate billions of entities. This is Herman, the founder. He wants to simulate a whole city so you can shut a bridge in one place and see what the traffic would do in another place. He's working with the military. He's helping simulate the whole internet. What happens if the cable on the Atlantic goes down? Because massive amounts of data and new ways of visualizing it allow you. We've had $3 billion invested in startups in this world, like Magic Leap. We don't know much about Magic Leap. They've put videos like this online. It could, I guess when you've got $3 billion, you can build all sorts of things. They have actually put out a little demo like this one, which they claim hasn't been augmented. It's probably going to be kind of 4 or 5 years before we get a better sense of where this is all going. But that machine that is on your desk, or even in your pocket, maybe that's not going to be the way you do your business, you connect to the network. And we talk about reality, but I'm now starting to think about post-reality. So post-reality is when people are now shaving their eyebrows to paint on eyebrows that look better on Instagram. Post-reality is when you follow the sat-nav rather than your eyes and end up in that river. Beware of post-reality. I'm still a fan of reality. And finally, I guess the best of these successful companies are finding ways to partner with the startup so that you can think a bit more like the startup. Because every sector is being unbundled. This is just one example. CB Insights have taken the web page of HSBC Bank and they've taken every service that the bank is offering and shown which startups are trying to take that business away. Mortgages, foreign currency transaction, insurance. And whatever business you're in, this is your reality too. And so if you're a big successful industrial conglomerate that's got 300,000 employees like GE, how on earth do you move forward? So Jeff Immelt is moving forward by partnering with startups that are building crowd-designed cars. There's one called Local Motors. And they've created a workspace in St. Louis called First Build where there's a kind of hacker ethos. Anybody can come in off the streets and prototype new products. And rather than spend 2 years and $20 million prototyping a refrigerator inside GE, you can do it in 8 weeks and $20,000 here. And if it looks like it's got promise, then they'll take it inside the parent company. A Chinese phone manufacturer called Xiaomi has been innovating in interesting ways, working with startups. This is Lei Jun. He's often called a bit of a Steve Jobs copycat. He makes phones that look a bit like Apple phones, much cheaper, but very high-end phones. This is what his stores look like. Except he's actually very original in his business model. They make no money, Xiaomi, from the phones, from the tablets. They make it all on the accessories. And they've invested in 60 startups to make those accessories. So the best-selling air purifier in China that's Xiaomi branded is made by a startup. The best-selling battery pack is made by a startup. And those 60 startups, the company only puts $100,000, $200,000 in. I asked the guy behind the 60 investments they've made, why don't you make these in-house? Surely you'd have more control. He said, no, you don't understand. We have 8,000 people. If we were making the accessories, we'd have 20,000. We'd never be able to make a decision. Plus, the startups are going to survive only if they make what the customer on the street wants today. They're going to have to make those decisions. We couldn't make those decisions. We put him on the cover, actually, of Wired saying it's time to copy China. You'd think a creative company like Disney could make its own decisions, but even Disney is working with startups. Startup called Sphero, where you control the ball's movement through a phone. They were in an accelerator that Bob Iger of Disney was actually mentoring. He thought, we got this Star Wars coming out last December. Why not brand a Sphero product? It becomes one of the best-selling toys last Christmas. What about batteries? This is a company called StoreDot, a bunch of scientists of different disciplines using nanotechnology to charge a battery in 40 seconds. This is a real-time demo. Fresh approach. They're not traditional battery people. They've had investment from these people, and not because Samsung wants the batteries to explode, but because they know that you and I don't want to wait for our batteries to charge. So I will leave you with the scale of ambition of some of the startups that are out there. Planetary Resources is what I've got to know. It's trying to mine asteroids for the rare earth minerals. If you can catch an asteroid, it might be worth maybe $1 trillion. It's been funded. Or a company or a research project like this one, it's called BrainGate. This lady is paralyzed, tetraplegic, but she has a chip implanted in her brain that's controlling the robot arm so she can drink just by thinking that she wants to drink. So everywhere I'm looking, people are inventing things that sound crazy, but are just another future. So thank you for listening.